All right, we're going to get started. Thank you very much to everyone, both in the room and online, for joining us today. Today we have the sixth and final seminar in this round of plants and soil seminar series for the agriculture, the College of Agriculture Advancements in Ag seminar series. Today we have with us Dr. Bunyamin Turan from the Crop Development Center and the Department of Plant Sciences. He is a professor and a Ministry of Ag Strategic Research Program Chair in chickpea and flax breeding and genetics. Dr. Turan is originally from South Sumatra, Indonesia. He came to Canada to do his master's and his PhD at the University of Guelph in Ontario. Dr. Turan's work focuses on breeding and genetics, on improving crops to become a commodity that is profitable for farmers in Western Canada. Since he joined the Crop Development Center in 2006, his program has released 13 chickpea varieties for growers in Western Canada. And now 90% of the chickpea varieties grown across the prairies are from the CDC. And as of spring 2021, Dr. Turan has also started work on flax as leader of the only flax breeding program in Canada. So we are very happy to have Dr. Turan with us today, and I will let you take it away.
Well, thank you very much, Daniel, for arranging for the seminar and for the introduction. I don't know where you get that information. So the introduction. I don't think I gave her that information. So thanks again, everyone, for coming in for my seminar. And then thanks for those who are joining online. So my talk today is about chickpea and flax plus breeding. Probably there's a plus in there. So not just only chickpea and flax, breeding and genetics. So the major one, these two crops, and a journey of two superfoods. Okay, so before, okay, so before I start my talk, I'd like to thank a long list of people, staff, collaborators who've been working for this program. So from the Pulse program, from the Flax program. So, okay. Yeah, so the Pulse program, we have long list of staff, technicians working in the program. We share with other program with pea, lentil, bean and fava bean. So Brent Barlow, Jared, Stacy, Kevin, Young, Dana, long list, and then also staff who work in the building, working on the research, Carmen, Sweta, and Tamana on the research basis. And we have students here, Elizabeth, Alana, just finished last December, and Sophie working on the chickpea program. And we also have a sub-program on flax breeding and research. So Ken Jekyll, the lead technician in the flax program. Shannon is here working for a long time on flax. She knows all about flax, so I learned a lot from her. Yeah, so we have Barb, Kenzie, and Keiko, and Tony, or Trish working with Randy, but also working with flax. We have on the research program on flax, Megan is here. The superwoman working on flax. So we have you also helping the flax, and Sampurna, student Sinjay is here, and also Jean from Green Innovation that always helping us with the quality analysis, breeder seed facilities, all collaborators from pulse pathology and serial pathology program, all collaborators at CDC, former student, technician, so long list to make a program. So it's not like an individual effort when you run a program. This is a team effort. So that's what I thanks to everyone for their contribution, for their hard working. So there's so many claims about the superfood. Okay, you can see from highly reputable magazine. So for example, in the future, everything will be made of chickpea. That kind of very optimistic, very ambitious a target, but it's there already. Okay, so superfood of the month, chickpeas, and spotlights cooking with chickpeas. So that's and then it's numerous. You come across with so many things about a claim like this. Same thing with flax. Yeah, so you can see the original superfood, flax seeds, And the flax is a nutritional powerful. So kind of that's from Mayo Clinic. So that's a very, very prestigious research. And the Guardian Superfood talking about linseed. So when I took, when I look into all this hype about this ambition, and then it came to like a, my almost like a naive questions. Okay, if chickpeas are flax or super in any way, so why not everyone eating it? Okay, why are people still rejecting it? Okay, that's kind of a question, really simple. And why not we growing it to produce a million tons of this chickpea or flax? So that's a question. So what are the challenges that we have? Okay, so that's kind of a where we go into the research and breeding here. So when you look at here, number one challenge, this is probably true for chickpea and flax, maybe other crop. First, we have very short growing season. So chickpeas requires about 100 on average. We chickpea about 100, 120 days to mature. We only have on average 110 or less frost-free growing periods. And then also in terms of the degree growing days, we have much less than what required for chickpea to mature in time. So that's what the first challenge. So we have to make chickpea to be able to produce to get. Yeah, sorry about that. So before I can do any breeding, we have to clear first what is the target here. So that's the challenge there. And then just recently, Sabina Group, the pathology, published this, looking at the pathogenicity of different kind of complex of fusarium in chickpea. So you can see here, even the picture here, if you are in this room, you can see this is one of the symptomatic when it's inoculated with Fusarium affinensium. It's gone. That's the easy leader that we have, unfortunately. Yeah, so this is the new challenge that we need to go into this chickpea program. So, but fortunately, if you look at the whole spectrum of the germplasm that Sabine and her group working on, there's already variability for this reaction for Fusarium. So there's a hope that we can do some breeding. Sorry about that. So now we're back to hand-free. Yeah, so this is the new disease, Fusarium, that's coming into. So probably this is due to climate change and warming in the environment. So I noticed maybe 10 years back when I started to see some sporadic symptomatic in the field. Now it's kind of more and more frequent you see in the field. So this is another one that we challenge in here. This is kind of the competitive advantage of the commodities compared to others. It doesn't matter how good your variety is. If you don't have any competitive advantage for the farmer, they will not growing it. you can see when canola is zooming, it will grow into all yellow crates. So that's the reality that we see that. Okay, so that's the reality. So the challenge for us is how we keep the commodity that we breed, that we release, still maintaining that competitive advantage. So this is another challenge that we have. So that we people or farmer will maintain this rotation between cereal, oil, seed, and pulses in their rotation, 3 or 4 year rotation, or even those who are affected by aphanomyces root rot, you need to expand it to 8 year rotation. So this is what the goal in chickpeas. So number one, we look at into competitive advantage for farmers. So it is yield. Okay, farmers get paid by bushel per acre. Seed size in chickpea really important. So the different seed size bring up to, at some point, 20 cents per pound price difference of different size of chickpea. So that's a nutritional quality, how we can include that into the factor in and times the price. So I put price, so price is beyond the breeding. And then number two is a reduced risk and production cost by increasing Ascochyta blight resistant, Fusarium root rot. This is another aspect that we need to work on, early maturity and frost and heat tolerance, easier management, such as herbicide tolerance. Now that all the new varieties that we release have resistance to imidazoline and herbicide, upright plant stature, so that easy for farmers to combine, and consumer preference, seed appearance, grain processor, canning and milling efficiency, nutritional characteristic, protein, oil, micronutrients, carotenoids, and we continue to produce alternative product, for example, frozen green chickpeas for certain market. Okay, so when you look at on the global scale, we're not a big producer of chickpeas. So we produce about probably 170 to 200,000 metric tons per year. Okay, the larger exporter for chickpeas is Australia, the first one here. I didn't include even India here. So India produced on average from 2016 to 2021, 10 million metric tons of chickpeas. And yet they still imported peas and lentil from Canada, because they are usually, on average, they're in short about 2 to 3 million metric tons for pulses for India. So that's, but India produce kabuli. They're not consuming, they produce kabuli, they export it back to the market. So that's now become a challenge for us. So in terms of production, probably Canada is about 10 to 12 exporters. But on the yield side, we are on the high, a little bit on the higher end. So we are on average at the farm levels about 1600 a kilogram per hectare producing. So the only one that looks to be higher is Mexico. So, but this is up and down as well. So Argentina, Canada, and United States are quite similar. But you have to look close attention as well in United States. So the majority of variety in United States, actually our variety being grown there. You can see the data, the acres in US is very adaptable, the variety that we release here. So this is what we have right now at the farm level. So if you look at the yield data from year 2000 to 2020 from the FAO start, so it's increasing. So we gain about 40 kg per hectare per year. That's quite significant if you look at the data. Okay, so we need to push more into this. If you look at the yield on our regional trials, so this is regional trials in the average from 2015 to 2020 across the Alberta, part of Alberta and Saskatchewan, we have about 2,250 kg per hectare. That's on average. So there's still gap about 400 kg per hectare. So this is, we need continue to, on the breeding side, to push the slope here higher to get the yield potential higher. And also need to continue working on the improvement of the agronomy, crop management to minimize the gap into this. So we may not get all 100% 400 kg, but if you go at least 25%, 30%, 40% of that, it's already big jump into yield at the farm level. That's what we need to bring. So this is kind of not just one factor, it's more the whole approach of crop production. Okay, so now we look at the early maturity. So early maturity, we look back to research many years ago. One of our students, Tom, and my student Ketema, working on early flowering, early maturity, a number of papers looking at the insensitivity to day lengths. And then that's leading us into the identification of ALF3 as a key genes that kind of control the response of chickpeas into the day length, into the putiferiod. So we clone the genes and we look at their differences in CDC frontier late flowering and MSCCB early flowering, and we tested the function of the genes. But because we don't have any regeneration transformation system working in chickpeas, reproducible, so we use Arabidopsis to test the function of those genes. So we transform the mutant Arabidopsis for this gene, and we see the response exactly as we expected. So we get that paper. Now we continue using that as a one way to push the maturity. For example, here, CDC frontier, this is the wild type, and this is the introgress, the neurasogenic line. So we did that by introgressing using marker selection and then background selection. So after BCT F6, we have this, and it's flower about 27 days. Normally, frontier flower 40 days to 45 days. But on the maturity side, this we gain about 3 to 5 days. So that's one aspect. So there's still other factor that we need to push more into the early maturity. The second one is how we handle with the Ascochyta. So mostly with the Ascochyta, we look at all the variability that exists in the germplasm collections. As you see here, this is the screening, and then we took at the best. And also now we start looking at into Fusarium root rot, what is the variability that we see in the field. So we have a number of papers published on Ascochyta black related. And so the major things that we see from all this experiment and research is that the order of important QTL for resistant is from chromosome 4, 2, 3, 5, and 8. So 4 and 2 is kind of the basis that we need to have for the resistance. And then these other additional QTLs may kind of help to maintain the resistance. So we're working on this, and we continue working on what this kind of gene involves. So we use this approach. This is unpublished data. RNA sequencing QTL in 4 real population. We do RNA sequencing on the parental lines, and we did a GWAS on the diverse germplasm in chickpeas. And we look at, for example, here region across the whole different population. So we narrow down into potential candidate genes that are located within the QTLs that may be involved in the resistance. Okay. And then we're also looking at, for example, here, combining the GWAS and real populations. And we have this one kind of peak here that matching nicely between the two. We're also looking at into the map and looking at the physical map sequence, and then combining that with the RNA-seq data. So we narrow down here as potential, those are involved in the plant's defense systems. Okay, so we have a list of potential candidates within the QTL for resistant to Ascochyta in chickpeas. So this kind of the approach that we pursued, and we ended now with a list of candidate genes. Now come into the hardest part of this altogether. So how we test this function and regulation of these candidate genes? That's the hardest part that we kind of challenge. So we almost kind of stop right here, yeah, because of the capability that we have here. So if we know that, then we can test the induced plant defense, then we can use the gene integration, or we do the editing and mutation so that we go into improved line, whether editing the susceptible genes or resistance. So that's another way. So this is kind of the framework we're looking for. In the meantime, so Elizabeth is here. So we expand the searching for the resistance for chickpeas. So we know that there are two species here, especially Judaicum. Judaicum belong to like some classified as secondary. The other classified as a tertiary gene pool. It's one of the best source for resistance for Ascochyta. Very low. It's not immune, but there's very low infection in Judaicum. But it's not crossable with Haryatinum. So we use the third species, Pinnatifidum, which is kind of can bridge between these two. So Elizabeth is working on this project. She's right here. Yeah, so continuing looking into this. And the question is that how we can, the number one question is that how the genetics control of this in these two species? And is there any unique resistance that we don't have in the cultivated chickpea. So kind of combining the two. And then if we know that, then we can introgress into the population. So just an example where we screen Elizabeth and Tamana screen in 2021. You can see here, okay, it's a score like a 1.5 to 2 on the 0 to 9 scale. And you can see it's susceptible, is completely gone. So this is the new source for the future, for the resistance to Assafoetida blind. Yeah, abiotic stress tolerance. So we're really mining a wild relative. So this is coming from the new collection that we have a while back. And then we develop populations, 200 lines, and then we test them for abiotic stress tolerance. So just published August in 2022. So basically what we did, so we selected from 500, reduced to 200, and we still maintain the diversity. And we grow this line at two seeding dates, 2 years in Saskatchewan, in Moose Jaw and Lucky Lake. This is normal seeding date and late seeding date. And then to really expose the line to stress conditions, no irrigation in Yuma, Arizona, we did the seeding date one and two. So seeding data, you can see here, this is the maximum temperature recorded during the flowering. So you can see in Yuma, Arizona in 2020, it's really smoked them like with the 38.9 degrees Celsius during flowering. So that's, now we calculate all the abiotic stress index on these populations. So you can see here, most of the heat sensitive line will be aborted the flowers, and whereas the tolerant one will be a continuing producing pot here. So that's the striking difference. So this is the plot in Yuma, Arizona. So we got it, the picture just before the close down for COVID. So just the timing, so March 12, 2020. By the end of the month, if I miss 1 week, I wouldn't be able to see to go into this place. So that was very timely at that time. So we get the data and then do the GWAS, and then you can see there are genetic components associated with the stress tolerance here across different index. So this published a few months ago. Now, Sophie is working on this population and she look into the genetics specifically for the heat tolerance in chickpeas. So she look at combining those GWAS and RNA-seq and test all the known genes associated with heat tolerance under control condition in phytotron downstairs. So up to, we get maximum at 35 degrees Celsius adjusted. So the plants were adjusted for the flowering, so synchronized for flowering, so that they all will be hit at the same time with the heat tolerance. So it's an ongoing project for Sophie. She just transferred from master to PhD to work on this project. On the seed quality, so we published Tamana work on her PhD, looking at into when you want to have a high iron in the seeds. So the question you want to have is, where's the iron coming from? Is it directly absorbed from soil, or is it translocation from different organ? So she looked into that and then she tested a number of lines under hydroponics. So we control the lines. At the time, there was a plan to use isotope iron, but we couldn't get it. So then we just do with the more like conventional. So she looked into all the disposition. It was a kind of a little bit large, massive undertaking for her, but she managed to do that. And she looked at all the genes involved in the iron absorption, translocation, and accumulation, which one involved in the translocation and accumulation. So this is part of the biofortification strategy in the future if we work on this part in chickpeas and maybe other crop. Yeah, so genomic and new approach. So we have Alana working on this project. She tested a genomic selection for seed and protein oil content in chickpeas. So we have a model here, a germplasm lines, and then testing it into different population, which is all the entries in the regional test, and using different model, statistical model. And you look at here the two population. This is the validation population and training populations. Oil. It's quite stable across environment. So it's not much a G by E or environmental effect. Whereas protein, you can see up and down in different population or growing season and year. So she developed a model. Can we predict from one population and then predict the performance of the other? Looking at cumulative blobs and growing location, growing year, and then testing it, marker density, and looking at different model. So basically here for the protein, basically zero prediction ability. There is no prediction ability for protein, unfortunately. So on the oil, it's about 20% prediction ability that we can get from this. But remember, most of the publication, if you look closely, they're using the same population as for validation and for training model. So we use different population. That's the difference here. So it's about 20%. Well, it's okay. There's something there that we can use. And then in terms of the markers, density, the lowest one based on LD, 25% LD is give the same efficiency for oil prediction. We have papers who work together with the group. This is, we discussed it when I was on sabbatical with Rajiv, and then we got this publication done. So again, one of the
leading. Here,
any question? We have this approach in the breeding.
Let me sit on it for a bit.
Okay, so sorry about that. So we have this 3,366 genome sequence and the flow pan genome, and then there's a different model for genomic selection being proposed in that paper. Okay, so now moving on Flax. Okay, so in Flax, we look at the basic breeding program here to look at into yield. We have to really catch up into the yield. This is resistance maintenance for example, rust and powdery mildew, improvement for fusarium wheel and pasmo, straw management, lodging resistant, acceptable seed quality, and abiotic as well. And we try to look at, is there any potential to improve the quality? Oil about 50%, ALA 60-70%, protein and plant stature, and also looking at a way to reduce the anti-nutritional compounds such as CG and cadmium in Flax. So in Flax, so we are among the largest producer globally, followed by a number of in the Black Sea regions, Kazakhs and Russian Federation. On the yield, we are actually right on the top here. If you look at the yield average between 2015 and 2020. So we are about 1,315 pound per acre and much higher than any other Flax producing country, but still not enough. Ideally, we should be around like 1,800 pounds per acre. That's where we should to make Flax really competitive with other commodities in the province. So that's kind of the target. If we can get maybe not 1,800, we can get up to like 1,600 at the farm level. That's I'll be happy with that. Yeah. So in Flax, for example, we have the average yield at the farm level about 1,300. Okay, and then the variety that we tested, the newer one, we have about like 2,200, 2,500. Pound per acre, so still about 700 pound per acre gap between the potential. So this is another aspect in agronomy that we can improve on working all together for Flax yield. And when I started the program, so I look at the data from Randy. So Randy and group been screening for years of for pasmo and fusarium wheel. So I look at the data, there are potential here. So immediately when I started the program in 2020, we use this the best line here to making the cross. Now we have about 133 populations segregating for this PASMO specifically designed. So that's for the new improvement that will come into the program. And Megan is here. Megan is leading the project on the speed breeding and Flax. So we optimize the program. Can we increase kind of the shorten the time to Flax to complete its cycle? So we tested temperature and as well as the day length, so 22 hours light, 2 hours dark seem to be working well. And kind of there are three scenarios here. The first one is to develop real populations. So we have two populations segregating for pasmo and fusarium wheel, three populations actually. So for disease resistant. And second one is, can we use this technique to combine with phenotypic selection in the population to develop quickly inbred lines for yield tests, as well as to combine this with molecular assisted selection for disease and other traits in Flax. So this is scenario that we're working. Megan leading on this project, and also we can expand into mining wild relative in Flax. Just remember that Flax initially, like when I look around, Initially, flax was domesticated for fiber. You can see here the fiber flax here. And then from there, kind of it's re-domesticated for the seed yield. That's why you see all the newer one of kind of very narrow diversity that we have here. So this is the progenitor of cultivated flax, which is Linum bionis. So we need to go back into the source and then domesticate it or cross directly with the original source to get into the high yield. So this is kind of the one of the look like when you look at into the new flax that we'll see. So very high biomass, high harvest index. So this is how we're gonna boost the yield in flax. So go back to the original source instead of go back into the sources that were selected initially for fiber. So this is where we make a jump in yield. So that's my, at least maybe by the time I'm retiring, I get something out of this. It's a long project, but this is where we go from the flax program. So Sinji is working on this, looking at into potential using bioenergy to improve PASMO and other traits. And she also looking at here, for example, 9 population that she worked. You can see here for PASMO in those progeny of crosses, very low. This is reaction for PASMO. So that's potential. We continue. And also because this is wild species, so there is a problem with the dehiscence. So she look at how we can remove the dehiscence quickly. So she did what we call bulk segregant sequencing and on the 3 populations and identify a number of QTLs that are associated with the dehiscence in flax so that we can remove this quickly from the progeny that we grow with flax. So, and then moving on the plus side, okay, so not just flax and chickpea, so we do on coriander as well. So there are two species, coriander and caraway, okay, so what we look at here is basically germplasm development and improve our blossom bike resistance and yield, essential oil, caraway or carob carfi. Caraway is so different than any other crop. This is a biennial crop. So it takes 2 years to get flower, to get seed yield. And it requires some fertilization for this caraway. So in the coriander, Sabin group, Sarichu and Sabin, been screening and then to narrow down what actually organism causing this disease in coriander. So they came up with these two species, Hesterophyra and Didi melacari. And there's some variability in the germplasm that we have. So I took into this data and then crossed that with the cultivar. So crossing crossing coriander is relatively easy. I don't need a technician. Okay, so this is the one that Shannon, you can get free of doing this or because you see, this is all done by bees. Okay, because this cross-pollinated. So basically we release bees here. We adjusted the flowering seeding to get the synchronized flowering and let the bees doing the work, making the crosses. So we did this, you know, just like a caravan here and put a sign here. So we did that. And now we have progeny. So this is the progeny that we have been screening for years, but we don't get much disease pressure in the field. And we did that in the greenhouse to get that pressure. So that's where we are now. So we'll continue again in 2023 with a multiple replication of the screening of the germplasm. So that's where we are with the coriander. And the next one on the caraway, there is no germplasm available. So we have to create our own variability. So we did mutagenesis EMS in caraway. So we have this M1 plants being grown. So Tamana taking care and then the painstaking with the caraway that you have to put into fertilization and back and forth to get into flowering, to get into the seed. So we hope we have something out of this mutagenized population. So with that, I'd like to thank all the support from the funding, from University, Saskatchewan government, Pulse Growers, WGRF, SASFLEX, SICAN, Pulse Crop Cluster, Manitoba Crop Alliance, Agri-Food Canada. So thank you for your attention. And if there's any questions. Any question?
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Tran, for that talk. For those of you online, if you have any questions that you want to put in the chat, we can read them aloud here in the room. But maybe first I will turn to questions in the room.
Thanks, Bunyamin. Very nice presentation. So my question is on the chickpea and Ascochyta, and it was nice how you outlined the various QTLs that have been described. So do you think that you have now pyramided all of those into locally adapted germplasm, or that's still ongoing?
Some part we accumulated. Just keep in mind some of the sources for those QTL, the resistance, are from the DESI. So it takes a while to go back into Kabuli type tone. So at least we have a major one on chromosome 4 and 2, and then plus one or two of the other minor ones. So the trouble with that, although you'll be able to look at the molecular level, you don't see it in the field. So kind of the level of resistance is not really kind of big jump or anything like that. So they look all performing the same, unless when you look at the molecular level where you see there are different QTL. So that's where we are right now, to kind of continue with crossing and selection to accumulate those possible sources for Ascochyta.
Any other questions in the room here?
Thanks, Bunyamin. That was really interesting. I have a question about your ELF3, the early flowering work. So you said, and I think I heard it right, that the flowering was advanced by a couple of weeks.
Yes.
But the maturity was only advanced by a couple of days. Yes. So that means your reproductive period was longer.
Yeah.
Did you get more yield, or was there any positive to having a longer reproductive period?
That's a very good question, Kirsten. So what happened is that we thought that's going to be a longer period for reproductive, but actually the plants start flowering while they don't have enough biomass to start with. So you gain into the earliness, but actually it's not as a lot of energy going into the reproductive organ too. So you don't get much of the yield boost on that one. So we need to get into that. So I think that's the natural biology you gain, and then you don't. So you plants start really early to flower, and then not much biomass after that, because maybe the energy already shared into the growing seed. So you don't get that boost of yield.
Questions?
Yeah, thanks, Bunyamin. Really enjoyed the breadth of seeing all the things that you're working on. There's a lot of crops under your portfolio.
Keep me alive, Chris.
So I had one question about the flax, and you mentioned as you go back to the wild accessions with the flax that you see more dehiscence.
Yeah.
Do you also see more dormancy in those accessions?
We haven't looked closely into that, Chris. So we did fertilization. So some of the parental lines, the wild one, require fertilization to get into flower. And the progeny seem to be kind of scattered all over. So basically, when we develop the population, we almost like remove those that dormancy requirement, the fertilization requirement. So whether any other mechanism of dormancy, we do not know. But at least right now, we look at into the dehiscence. So hopefully we can get the seeds out of it and then continue to use that as source for the new kind of a germplasm for the breeding for yield improvement. We cannot just rely on what we have right now in the germplasm pool. We have to go back, bring back all the diversity into the program. Thanks, Chris.
Thanks, Bunyamin. Simple question. So from the standpoint of marketability on chickpeas, are we interested in bigger seeds or smaller seeds? And is there a price premium for one or the other?
Very good question. That's the essence of all those, Trevor. So for Kabuli, we need to have really bold seed 1 centimeter or higher size, because that gives the premium. So if you compare, for example, 10 mil compared to 0.8 mil different size, it could be translated into 10 to 20 cents per pound price difference. That's very striking. So farmers, for example, Mike, you see, you were right that we really CDC PASCO. Actually, there's a yield penalty for that one. Well, farmers like it because it's given the premium because of large seed. But having said that, I'm not throwing all the smaller seed. For example, for a market such as processing for hummus, they don't care about the seed size. As long as we get the smaller seed, but yield up to like 20% of the check, I'll keep it. So we release that. So that's another example CDC pearl we release is smaller seed, but very high yielding, high protein, which is where the market, the processing like to have that. So we keep that all in balance. So I think in a breeding program, we look at all possible opportunity that we look at. So we don't want to throw anything at this point. So yes, the larger seed is the target, and smaller seed also there's a market there.
And do you work with both Kabuli and
Desi?
Desi?
Yes, so we do both Kabuli and Desi. And even in Desi, there is kind of segmented into different markets, black seeded Desi, yellow seed, yellow cotyledon Desi. So that's the organic farmers, for example, they like really separate from the conventional chickpeas. So they use that. And as well as green Kabuli for the fresh market. So there's a market just like a green peas, frozen, immature seeds. So we produce that for targeting that market. So a lot of possibilities in chickpeas.
All right, again, if there are any questions online, you can feel free to put them in the chats. All right. Well, in that case, I guess I will thank Dr. Tran on behalf of everybody online and in the room. Thank you very much for wrapping up our final seminar in the series.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm sure you stop saying that. Yeah, okay.